We're getting ready to start our series on the condition of character. This is the ending series that I felt that God, out of all the things that we did starting the year, we were going to close with character. And last week I gave you a prelude to all the different mini-series that we're going to do. We're going to talk about Psalms 1, Blessed is the Man. We're going to talk about the conflict within in Romans 7, the two enemies that fight, which is your flesh and your spirit. We're going to talk about controlling our anger, but not the actual verbal abuse that anger comes in. How many know that God is good? We're right where we're supposed to be, and I'm going to just tell you this. You know, I did the prelude of what we're going to do, and God granted with this anger series because, you know, like me, I lose my temper, and I'll spit out some cuss words, or I'll cuss you out. It's just part of the flesh. And then I have to go back and say, I'm sorry, I lost my temper. And you know, and I'm like, God, is it always going to be this way? Well, I'm not going to preach that fake stuff. I'm going to preach the real stuff. You're going to lose your temper, and you're going to say a cuss word. Okay? Let's just be real. It's okay. It's not a sin. Nowhere in the Bible it says cussing is a sin. I looked it up, I searched and searched. Cursing is a sin when you curse someone with a spell of witchcraft or evil will. Okay? But I imagine when Jesus was in the temple, and I imagine when Noah got mad, I imagine when Elijah was on the mountain of the 700 prophets, what cussing is, it's an emotion. And it's another thing in your life that you need to get under what? There you go, people. Let's just keep it real. All right? So, when do we cuss? When we're angry, right? We seem to lose it. We hit our hand with a hammer, or our kids disrespect us, or somebody talks back to us, or our boss pisses us off, or our husband makes us mad, or our wife makes us mad, or our mama makes us mad, or our dog makes us mad. I've just got all these things. This is true for me, okay? I don't know about you, but I know about me, okay? So all these things happen, right? And you'll say a cuss word, and then those that are saved, you'll kind of feel convicted about it later. And that's when I said, okay, it's okay. I got angry, I destroyed the whole world, but it's okay. You said a few cuss words, now go in and apologize. Listen, God says, don't apologize to me. Go apologize to the person you cussed. Oh, man. So that's where we're at. And then there's the other anger that makes you kill. You actually physically, violently kill somebody or hurt somebody or put your hands on them or destroy them or even breaking something. You know, you little people that go and punch holes through the walls? And kick stuff. That's still violence because you know that's your mom and dad you're doing that to. Whosoever lusts after a woman, if then his heart and his mind has done the same as adultery. So if you pick up something and say, oh, I hate you, mama, bam, bam, and you break it all up, that's the same as you beat me in the head. Watch those things. So when God gave me this anger series, we're not talking about those things. Those are the natural things that lead to anger. What we want to talk about when I do the anger series is the subtlety and the sin of unrepented anger. An anger that you let subside within you. Anger that has no resolve, or that you haven't resolved it with your friend or your lover or your husband or your wife or your mom or your dad or your girlfriend or some classmate from 1983 that you still hate. It's those things that if we don't deal with those angers, it's going to lead to a spiritual sin that grows within us. And let me tell you how I know we're right on this. Because last Tuesday I was going through my Facebook, and another girl in Arizona that listens to the sermons, she put this post on T.D. Jakes. Well, guess what he's preaching about? Anger. Controlling anger. The same part of it that I want to discuss. And so I was telling Mom, I said, Mom, she goes, you know that's confirmation. I said, I know. But see, those that are the sons of God are led by the Spirit of God. Now, I love T.D. Jakes. I may not agree with his lifestyle, but I love the man of God who he is. And it's not for me to judge him for what he does in his personal life and what he does with the money that God gives him. That's between him and God. But as the man of God, T.D. Jakes, I love him, but I don't listen to him, okay? Because for me to listen to someone, I have to like you all the way around. Now guess who I love? Jesus. I like him all the way around. There ain't nothing that Jesus did. When he beat up people at the temple, I still like him. When he turned water to wine and gave all you Catholics reason to get drunk, I still like him. You see what I'm saying? Because I like everything about him. So I want to let you guys know that you guys are getting the word from those that are led by the sons of God. You guys are getting the fruit that God has given the church in and out of season. A timely fruit. Is there something about what we're supposed to do that God is trying to do to us? There's something about what we're learning this last past year that God is trying to do to us. And so as we go into the character series, this is very, very pivotal for your life. It's like the summation of everything you've heard in 2015, and God is asking you, what are you going to do with the food that I fed you with? Are you going to absorb it into your character and try to become what the word has been? I've had my servant Mike preach it to you and break it down street style, teenage style, old folk style, and middle age style. So you ain't got no reason not to have taken of the word of God I gave you. And if you don't take what God has given you in 2015, then you will not cross over into 2016. Spiritually, you will be left behind. Listen, we're on a journey. We're on a course where God is pruning and grooming and getting ready. He's cutting away the things that have held you back for many of years. He's cutting away at the things that, the secret sins of your life that you thought nobody knew about. He's exposing the weaknesses that we walk in day to day, and he's gravitating you to the strength that he has for you individually in your own life. Not in your wife's life, not in your husband's life, but in your life only. Because the Bible says that every man and woman work out their own salvation, work out their own salvation, work out their own spiritual growth, work out their own spiritual problems, work out their own relationship with God. So when you stand before him, you cannot say, oh, the devil made me do it. It was my husband. He drove me crazy for years. It was the damn kids I had to raise. They all went through the hard and went to the penitentiary. God, you know what I went through. You know? You're not going to have no excuse. It's going to be you. And you're going to stand before God. And God's going to say, SP, I don't care about all that. Man, I don't care about all that. I don't care about the sins of the flesh. I want to talk about the things you did from your heart. I want to talk about the condition of your heart. And this is why it's important. God says, I want to talk about your character. I gave you every opportunity to get it right. I've turned you from that road to this road. I led you down that street instead of that street. I stopped the gates of hell from getting ready to overtake you. I held back the prince of darkness that was coming to steal, kill, and destroy. I stopped things in your path that you didn't know about to put you right in the church that you're supposed to be. But yet, because the word was strong, you left. Because you wanted to go get where there was no conviction in your life. How can you learn the word of God and not have conviction in your life? The whole thing about God is conviction. It's conviction to do right. Spiritually, physically, emotionally, and morally. That's why so many people hate church. It's not a bunch of rules. It's a lifestyle. It's a condition that we must condition our heart to live in. It's a world that we live in that says you don't have to do this and you don't have to do this. But when you come into God's world, God says, this is what you have to do. This is what I need you to do. This is the road that you must travel. Because you've called not to travel the same road as everybody else. I've called you to a different road. So you do like Mike did. You run from him. You blame God for everything. You numb your mind so you don't have to deal with the things of the Spirit. You try to forget that life even exists. Sometimes you even want to die and take your own life. And yet, all because you refuse to live in God's world. You refuse to let your world embrace God. And you say, God, I don't want it. God, I don't need it. God, I can't have it. Not now, God. Not now, God. Later, God. Later, God. I'm still young, God. I haven't even begun to be promiscuous yet, God. I haven't even got drunk and threw up on the toilet like my dad used to tell me. I haven't even became a crackhead yet, God. I ain't even went to jail yet, God. Not even arrested yet, God. Why? Why? Why do we want to gravitate to those things instead of what? Surrender. Listen, we're learning the word of God so that we can know what pleases God. And God just wants us to be pleased unto Him. He wants us to be obedient over sacrifice. That means we sacrifice the desires of the flesh to have the things of the Spirit. And this is why this is so important. I'm giving a long intro before we start because I want you to know how important this series is for your life. And I feel by God that it's a warning that I need to warn you that those that do not take heed to what God is saying, there's something in 2016 that people are going to grow around you. You're going to wonder why you're still stuck. Because you can't move forward until you learn what God wanted to give you. That's what the Bible says. Repent and go back to your first words. Why your first words? Because you have to start all over. You just can't go and just go right to the top because you did not learn character. You did not allow God to shape you and mold you before He was about to give you. See, how many know that you can't have everything that God wants to give you until your vessel is ready to receive it?
Yep.
So how many knows that it takes years sometimes for you to receive what God has promised and ordained for your life from when she was in your mother's womb, from the foundations of the earth? God has already appointed that Espy, Lorraine, you're going to do these great things. And then you wonder, well, why is my life so miserable? Because your vessel is not ready yet. Because all the things that you go through in your life is to get your vessel ready. Yes, all the pain, all the scars, all the trials, all the defeats and all the victories is to shape you for what God wants to pour into you. And as a man wrote me when I was a young boy in front of a bunch of people, he said, God is going to use you mightily because of your heart. So this is why the condition of our heart has to be right. And I've been waiting. I'm 50, going to be 51. And I'm waiting for God to still use me mightily. You see, even my vessel is not ready yet. I'm still being pruned and groomed. I'm still being shaped and molded. God is still questioning me, Mike, what's the condition of your heart? Can I trust you with the vision that I gave you? Can I trust you with the promise to come? And I say, yes, God, and He says, not yet. And I said, but I'm ready, God. He says, not yet. I said, but God, I want it now. He says, hold on. Let me continue to test you. Let me continue to make you worthy. See, I don't want you to do like Moses did. In the end, I want you to finish strong like Elijah. Amen. And I'll come and get you.
Right.
Today I want to talk to you about the condition of the heart. God told me something when I was a young man. He said, I don't ever want you to go through the motions of serving me, the motions of loving me. Because when you go through the motions of serving God, it becomes a condition. A condition of your heart. Not a condition of your mind. It becomes the very essence that's what's in you that some people think in their mind they're serving God with all that they have, but they're not. Because deep in their heart, they haven't given them that most sacred part. You see, when you begin to go through the motions, you develop bad habits. How many know that the church has so many bad habits? It's pathetic. They teach you how to gossip. They teach you how to sin. They teach you how to not ask for forgiveness. They teach you how to hate your brother. They teach you all the things that you can learn out in the world. So you go to the church and you become worse. I could have did better out there with the Crips and the Bloods. Yeah, because you know what? They have a code. They ride or die for theirs. They serve each other with their lives. I don't want to bring it straight, but I'm just saying. So we come to church and that's when we learn how to be what? Fake. We're not here because your pastor, he gonna put the hot coals on you. That's why ain't nobody here. But all on YouTube, they be watching, pimp you. But they don't want to even come in the flesh. They just like to watch God from a distance. And so I say, God, every time they try to sneak that word in, bam, hit him, Jesus. Bam, and then they're like junkies. They go back. Where's the next one? One man sowed, one man planted, but God brings the increase. And I just say, God, get him. You see, we've been going through the motions so long. And God is saying, I'm looking for the few, the chosen. Yes, the Marines. Those that will go where no other goes. Those that will serve. I'm looking for that Joshua. I'm looking for that Caleb. See, nothing in Joshua and Caleb's life did they do as going through the motions. Even when they had to go and escort Moses and sit on the mountain for 40 days, they didn't quit. They wasn't like the disciples when Jesus went to pray the night before he was taken to jail. And he went and he says that he prayed until his tears was as drops of blood. And he comes back and he finds them all asleep. And he says, could thou tarry with me for at least 1 hour? I'm about to die tonight. Man, I'm the dude that turned the water to wine. Rose the dead. You've been with me for 3 days. You couldn't pray on my night that I'm about to get killed. You couldn't pray with me for an hour? Have you been going through the motions? I've been telling you and telling you and telling you that my time has come. Can you imagine the reprimand they got? Get up! Now listen, that example that I just gave you is the condition of the church. While Jesus was away, where is he now? He's sitting at the right hand of God, waiting for God to release him. Because no man knows the day or the hour or the time when Jesus shall come. So he tells us to be ready. And so what is the church doing? We're sleeping. He's there up there praying night and day. God, don't destroy my David's life because this is the one we've called to go to the multitudes. Don't destroy him right now. I know he's bad, but what did we do? He's praying and he's waiting. He says, oh God, not yet. I got a few more to get right. I got Danny and Johnny and I got Matt and I got Seth and Simeon and Vita and I got Jared and and I got Samantha. There's more, God. I know there's more. Hold on, God. And God is like, Jesus, but I need to come now. I'm sick of him. I'm about to throw the devil in hell. I am done. I want peace. But hold on, God. So all this time that Jesus was away, he's away praying to God for us, for generation to generation. And so guess what? The church, the condition of their heart, they're just like those disciples. They've been asleep. Instead of being what Jesus says, we must be about our Father's business. We must have the urgency to make sure that we are anticipating his return. That means we can't be folding up the hands and kicking back, being familiar. We must be about God's business. But we can't be about God's business if God's not in us. We can't be about God's business if we play church. We can't be about God's business if we never open our mouths once we leave this room to say anything about God. For surely we're not going to be about God's business if we're not about God's business. And what is God's business? Bringing people to Jesus. It ain't rocket science. So when I ask you today, what's the condition of your heart? I ask you, do you love God with all your soul, with all your might, with all your strength, and with all that you have? Because when we do that, then I guarantee you will not go through the motions. I guarantee that everything in your life will be unpurpose and purpose. Everything in your life will be unpurpose and in purpose. Because that's what God is doing. So again, going through the motions is something that we don't want to do, because when we go through the motion, it means that you have a half-heartedness about you. That means that you have a routine about you that actually produces no fruit. That means you have a formality that you go through every Sunday, every day in your life, that bears no substance. It's just what you do. And that means you have a facade about you, which means you are superficial in your appearance, and you carry an illusion of something. That's the definition of going through the motions. And when God gave me this word, this is my word that I'm sharing with you guys. This is not what I'm calling you or saying that you're accused of or anything. Let this whole sermon be about Mike Davis, because I'm going to expose my weaknesses to make you strong. I'm going to expose my idiocracies to make you strong. I'm going to use myself as the example, because this is what God told me. Now, to he that is given, much is required. You may not be given as much as me, so you may not be required to have a life like this. But this is what God required of Mike Davis. And he said, Mike, I don't let you ever want you going through the motions and serving me. And I didn't. If I was in God, I was in God. If I was out of God, I was out of God. There was no gray area in my life. I did not play church, fake church, or go to church. When I hated God for 17 years, I did not touch a church. I wouldn't even read a scripture with my wife, who begged me to share the Bible with her. I was furious at God. I didn't want nothing to do with this fake church, this fake people, and people that have destroyed my life. So I wasn't going to play church because my mom was praying for my soul. I wasn't going to go to church because my wife was curious about who Jesus is. I didn't even care. I became the worst of the worst, the most evil of the evil, because I did not care. The condition of my heart was black. I didn't care, and I didn't even care. But yet, I had so much knowledge about God, and I would hear people talking about God, and I would think, man, he's so far from the truth. And I saw all the hypocrites come on TV, and all the fake people, and the devil just fed me more and more, and see, living for God ain't right. See? That's a shame. Look at that. It's a terrible thing when you know the word of God and you walk away from God. You have no peace, never. Everything just resonates as an echo. You see a mass murder, you see a killing, and you measure it with the word of God. You see this, you measure it with the word. The word of God is still living in you, even though you don't want nothing to do with God. In its total torment, I wish it was shut down, but it never shut down. God would never stop showing me that you belong to me. I don't care what hurts you have. You belong to me. I will not allow your heart to become black. And so, in the midst of me being in sin, God would do things like this. He would open my door and sending birds in my house and rest in my tree. And I'd be high as a kite. The door would open, and a sparrow would come and sit on my palm tree in my living room. And God would say, even the sparrows don't worry about how they shall live. And the bird would leave. I'd be at Home Depot buying something, and I'd have the God's name in Hebrew tattooed on my arms, and he would send an Orthodox Jew just to talk to me. Nobody else knew what I had. But out of the millions of people in Palmdale, California, he sent a Hebrew guy. He knew that I believed in my tattoos, and he knew that that would provoke me to talk about God, even though I didn't want to. So he would send an Orthodox Jew that says,
You can't have the name of God tattooed on your body. You have desecrated your body in him.
Now, I'm a big black man, and I have a body shirt on, and I'm high on crystal meth. And I'm like, fool, you don't even know me. I'm ready to crush this dude, right? And then all of a sudden, something would happen. And it'd be like, I don't want to change my heart. No, no, I don't want to tell him again. No, no. Well, this is why I put these tattoos on you, so you can have the opportunity. And all of a sudden, I'll be like, no, I hate you, God, I hate you. And then, man, the conflict within. And then, but yeah, and then I said, ah, oh, the anointing would hit me. Pow! Oh, you're an Orthodox Jew. Well, here's a question for you. You ready? Yes, because I'm well studied. I said, well, the word says, thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee, right? Yes. Well, since you guys didn't want to share the name of God, I did this. I said, thy name have I tattooed on my body, that I will always know the true name of Yahweh, my Elohim, Kai. And let me ask you another question, Mr. Two. Moses, Abraham, and Isaac was Hebrews. Why are you Jewish? And why did you change your name? And what language do you speak? Oh, you still speak Hebrew. Well, then I want you to go back to your great, all the way before Moses died, when you was Hebrews, and ask them, why are you Jews? And guess what they would do? They couldn't answer that question. They were raised Orthodox and not even knowing their own history, are in denial, are trying to push something away because somebody told them, you don't need to know that part. But then you're going to come and reprimand a Gentile, a heathen, a sinner, about why I got your sacred name? Because listen, I gave sweat and blood and tears since 21 to the gospel to learn God has a name and it ain't G-O-D. I lost a marriage trying to figure out, God, who are you? And what is your real name? Surely you must have a name. Oh yeah, I opened up the dictionary. God, Jesus, Son God, many gods. What? Surely my God has to have something that separates him from the other gods. Surely there has to be a truth that man don't want us to know about who God really is. Surely there is something more than all my years of going to every church from Catholic to Protestant to Pentecost to non-denomination to Jehovah's Witnesses. There's got to be a name of somebody whose name ain't God. And when I found it, I will never let go of the true name of God. Because I will pray like Elisha prayed. I will pray like Noah prayed. I will pray like Adam prayed. I will pray like Jesus prayed. I will pray to the real God who has a name. And I know his name. And I put it on my body. And I put God on my right hand because he's almighty. And I put Jesus on my left hand. And on my left side it says, Yahushua, the truth, the way, and the life. And I walked around and seen it in every Home Depot. Went down to Beverly Hills, nothing but Jewish people came up to me. Yahweh, Yahushua, how do you know those names? Who are you? Where do you come from? What tribe are you from? Got tribe Levi right here too. Tribe Levi, the priestly tribe. And I was like, yeah, what you want? And then it would open up. I remember I was down in Beverly Hills on Rodeo Drive, selling a car. Walked in there with a tank top. Must have been about 12 Jewish guys come up. And I said at the dealership, I'm ready. In sin, hate God. Here it goes, this is the hurt. Transform my, no, I don't want you. Leave me alone, I hate you, God. I don't want nothing to do with your church. But I'm not talking about you. I'm gonna let you talk about the Hebrew. No, no, and he transforms me. And then I took on all 12 of them. And I'd be with all of them with the word of God. In and out of season. And they were like, we hate them. And they walked out with their heads down. We gotta go back to Grandpa. We gotta go ask him. His dad was smarter than us. And he's a Gentile. He don't even want God. And they were Orthodox. These are things that have happened in my life that as I tried to separate myself from the church, these things would happen. And there's hundreds of more stories. I'll tell you one more. You know, this sermon is not even being preached, but I feel like this is important because we're talking about the condition of God. I'm talking about being true, okay? Being true to who you are. And even in sin where I hated God, God called me out of darkness. And even though my flesh fought him, I don't want to do it, the spirit inside of me would turn over and I would preach the word of God. And as soon as I was done, I'd go back to hating God. It was weird. But I wanted you to know that knowing the word of God and choosing to live in sin is the most miserable thing in your life. You will never be happy, especially once you find out the truth. You don't deserve to live nowhere but with God. And it will haunt you and taunt you until you go. That's why the Bible says, train up a child the way he should go. And when he is old, he shall not depart from it. That means those seeds that you planted will always bring him back, because you have taught him the truth on the highways. You have taught him the truth in your comings and goings. You have spoken the word of God at the dinner table when you're walking on the road. That's what the word says. Teach your children when you're walking, when you're eating, when you're sleeping. And Mom Davis, put it in us. And every last one of us have no excuse not to be serving God today. There was a time I was so high, and I had a lot of fast cars, and I was washing my cars, playing my music, boom, boom. And then one teenager would come by my gate. Then another teenager, just like birds that come and land on the telephone pole. You see one, and next thing you know, there's 65 of them. It was crazy. It was like 13 kids lined up. So they all admiring my car, and my MB Courts, and my Alpines, and my old Tinker body kit, and my old Tinker wheels, all my German stuff. My German cars didn't have Japanese stuff like these fools out here in El Paso. I had $30,000 worth of product that goes with the car. If my car was made in Germany, then everything was German on it. You didn't take a Japanese car and put German on it, or take a German car and put it. That's cheap people. That's why you see some of these tutors out here. They don't know anything. I had chips and ODB chips in it, and I had exhaust systems, and all my stuff was custom. So when you looked at my car, you was like, dang, dog, you got it going on, boss, huh? Yeah. So all these little fools lined up like this, like Baco Locos, listening to the homie. And they listen to the music, and they're like, dude, look at your car, man, that's cool. Next thing you know, no, Jesus, no! I don't want to talk about you! Click! God just came out. And I gave my first sermon to youngsters. And I think it was God testing to see if I could preach. Them boys wouldn't leave my gate for an hour and a half of me speaking the word of God to them. And I came in the house and I said, man, he did it again. I didn't want nothing to do with him. And he put these kids in front of me, and all of a sudden something just came over me. And I said, babe, they wouldn't even leave. They just let me share Jesus with them for an hour. And I even said, listen, kids, don't be like me. I'm jacked up. I gave them my whole life story. How I loved God and served God and lost my marriage in the church and this and that. And I warned them not to take the road that I had taken. Not to get hooked on drugs and all this stuff. And it was just a powerful moment. The only thing was missing was an altar call. But see, I wasn't in God. But these are the things, that's why I say, it's the most miserable position to be in, to know the word of God and not be serving God. So all you kids that are here, know this, that the seeds that have been deposited in your life is for a reason. And that God will never ever, the devil, the world, and crime, and sin could never ever take out what God had deposited in your life when you once was pure, when you once desired him, when you were seeking him and looking for him. And God deposits that in you. And that's the very thing that when you get away from your mom and dad's house, when you go off into your own world, when you get involved in things that you shouldn't be, and your world becomes dark, you must remember the things that was planted in you. Because guess what? You don't belong to the world. You belong to God. And God will take you and begin to turn that back. And even when you say no, it will automatically turn. And that's when God is coming. That's when God is saying, return to me, Brandon, Jared, Kevin. Return to me, man. You heard the words of Pastor Mike. You heard the words of your mom and dad. Don't allow something that happened to change the condition of your heart. Don't allow something that hurt you so physically, so emotionally, so morally, to change the condition of your heart. Your heart was made for me, and it belongs to me and me alone. When you let a girl in there that breaks your heart, shame on you. That's why you wanted to take your life. When you let drugs in there to change your heart, shame on you. That's why you become a drug addict. When you let lust in there to make you a prostitute or a male hooker, shame on you. That's why you live that life. Don't let nothing go inside of that place that God has preserved. Wherever God has touched you with innocence, you must remain and keep it. Wherever God has touched you in innocence, you must keep it. Because the devil wants to take the innocent seed that was thrown into your life, and he wants to take it out and replace it with a lie. And God is asking you, can he trust you? Can he trust you? Will you be faithful? Will you remember me when you're famous? You remember me when you're sad? Will you remember me when you're lonely? Will you remember me when you're frustrated? Will you remember me when you're depressed? Will you remember me when you're angry? Will you remember the seeds of innocence that I've given you? Stand up. I feel led to do this. I need every teenager up here. Let's go. Including my teenagers, come on. No, you're not turning facing the crowd. This ain't Star Search. Okay? Listen. The reason why I didn't get to start my sermon today is because of y'all. Do you know that? So, the sermon that I preach was the sermon that I was supposed to preach to y'all. And God has given me a word for every last one of you about your heart. And he told me to tell you, and he pressed it on my soul, to not let anything steal your innocence. And I have to explain this to you. Your innocence is the faith and love that you have for God right now. Before your life becomes topsy-turvy, before you leave the covering of your mom and dad and go out into the world, before you smoke your first joint, before you get drunk for the first time and throw up, before you have your first relationship that leads to sex, before that girl takes your mind or that boy destroys your mind, and does a hand trick on you that you can't find yourself nowhere. Before you do foolish things like Jonathan, Vita's friend, who got drunk and died this week, split his car in half on George Deal, and Vita was traumatized by her. Listen, don't let nothing change the condition of your heart. Right now, at this time, before God, there's an innocence about all of you. And God wants you to remember, to remember, to remember this moment. And be faithful to Him. Hold out and hold on as long as you can. Hold out and hold on as long as you can. Hold out and hold on. as long as you can, because the gates of hell is coming for your life. And you will have to fight with everything that you have to not lose the innocence that God has given you. Do you understand that, kids? Is that word clear to you? It's a word of encouragement that this day, and this time, and this hour that we live in, hell is coming for all of you. The devil's out to destroy all of you because he doesn't want one of you to serve God. And take it for an old 50-year-old pastor that's been there and done that, that's given you the word today to save your life tomorrow. And I just want to bless you all by covering you. So can I cover you all? Okay. Grown-ups, come on up and just gather around. We're gonna pray a covering over our kids. Those that have pimples on your forehead, sorry. I don't mean to add more oil to it. That looks so good at you. And you, and you. And then adults, we'll start. And you know what's funny? We're doing character. Is this not shaking character? An expression that I never thought that we'd be doing. I'm sorry, but I can't be put in a box, so I just got to do what God wants. Listen, 10 times 100,000. That's a million, right? That's how many people of your guys' lives are worth to impact in your generation. 10 times 100,000. Some that will go on to do greater things, be a general in the Air Force. You'd be a million. Be an NFL player, you'd be 3 or 4 million. To be a physical therapist, 1 million. You don't know. One of you will become a doctor. One of you become somebody that has a cure to something. One of you will come. Your life, what you are right now, will impact millions. But don't lose your innocence. Don't lose the seed that was planted. So let's pray. Father God, I just come before you and I thank you for all our children. I thank you for not our little children, for those who are still under the covering, but our teenage children, the ones that are at the age of accountability, the ones that have the understanding of knowing right from wrong, the ones that face temptation every day to get high, to have sex, to do something promiscuous, to ditch school, to start a fight, to steal from someone's house, to run in a car and do crime, to rob a store, whatever the temptation is, to be cool, to sag their pants, to do things that they know that they know that they know that they shouldn't do. But Father, we cover our children. We cover our young men and women. We cover them with the mighty blood of Yahushua. In the name of Yahweh Elohim Echad, our mighty one, from the tops of their head to the soles of their feet. And we say this, God, do not let the condition of their heart change. To guard their innocence before it is stolen and taken. And Father, we seal it up. We seal it up. We seal it up in the name of Jesus. We seal it up in the name of Jesus. We seal it up, Father. We seal it up, Father, so that no weapon, no temptation, no resist, no lust, nothing, no desires that is of you can come in and corrupt these souls. Now, Father, I know they're going to go out in the world. And I know that curiosity is going to drive them. I know, Father, that there's some things that they're going to have to touch, some things that they're going to have to be involved with, some things they're going to just have to try. But, Father, I pray right now that whatever it is that they decide to touch or to try or to intake, that it would not overtake them, Father. Father, that you would bring them back like the prodigal son to know that in my father's house, there's food to eat. In my father's house, there's joy. In my father's house, there's security and comfort. In my father's house, there's love. So, Father, wherever they may end up in their life, I breathe the blood of Jesus over their lives, through their lives, in their lives. I wash their minds with the blood of Yahushua. I wash their hearts with your goodness and your grace and your mercy. And I shield them from the enemy. I shield them from the lust. I shield them from the will to sin and do evil, Father. And Father, I ask that you would bless their lives to make them a light in their generation. That there's things and roads that they will not cross. There's things that they refuse to do, and they will not be ashamed to stand up and say, no, I will not do that. Father, I pray for strength. I pray for wisdom. And Father, I pray for the truth, and that you would increase their faith. Those that have great faith, that it would gravitate. Those that have no faith, that it would become faith. And those that have little faith, that it would become great faith. That they would continue to gravitate to you. Father, take their hearts as an offering this day. Take their hearts as an offering this day. So, Father, we give you our children. We give you our children. We say, Jesus, we don't trust nothing else in the world, but we trust you. And one day, Father, these children will become men and women, and they will grow up, and they will take on a life of their own, a marriage, children, and family, and careers, but Father, that they will never lose the innocence that was planted on. In Jesus' name, amen.